Creating triggers and interactable objects is very easy in Godot. The area and area 2D nodes provide a simple way of detecting and reacting to collisions of physics objects, like a player node. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to create a basic trigger, a reusable generic trigger, and a reusable interactable object. Let's get to it. We are going to start with that basic trigger. I've created this jump pad scene. The root node is an area node, and I have a collision shape, a mesh, and some particles and animation for a visual flare. I want the player to bounce off with a customizable amount of momentum when they touch the jump pad. In the script, I've already created an exported power vector variable. In the ready function, I also set up the particle direction to match the power vector's direction. To detect when the player touches the jump pad, I'm going to need to connect the area node's body entered signal to a new method in the script. You can quickly connect signals to nodes using the node tab signals page. We want to use the body entered signal here, since our player is a kinematic body. When we connect our signal, we get this dialog where you can choose the script and the method name to be used. Inside this new onBodyEntered method, we want to first check whether the physics body that entered is the player or not. There are multiple ways of checking whether this is the case. A very simple way is to give our player script a class name. We can then use the is keyword to check whether the body is of the player type. You can also use Godot's collision layer system to filter collisions. The layer property defines what layer the selected node is on, and the mask property defines what layers the selected node checks with when detecting collisions. Nodes can be on and check for collisions on multiple layers. If we, for example, set our player on layer 2 and have the area's mask on 2 as well, we would trigger this body entered signal. You can give the collision layers names in the project settings. Let's just use the isPlayer check here. Inside this condition, I can just set the player's movement vector to the power vector value, since we know for sure that we are dealing with the player node here. I'll also play the animation in the animation player. When we go in game, we can see that the jump pads are working as intended. Next, I'll show you how to make a reusable trigger node. In my level, I have this door that I want to open when the player is near and close when the player is further away. In the door script, I have these open and close methods that play the door's animations. To close the door, I just play the open animation in reverse. In my level, I also have this player trigger scene that I've made. You can see it takes a node path and the names of the enter and exit methods to call on that node. I have it set up here to activate the door opening and closing. Let's take a look at its script. You can see that it's pretty simple. I have the exported variables, and then in the connected body entered and exited methods, I check first whether the body is the player. I then check if the node path is empty. I also check whether getting the node works, in case it has been deleted or moved in the node tree. Lastly, I check whether the node has the method that we are trying to call. I can then safely call that method on the node. I print these errors for failing each of the steps, since we don't want to wonder why things are not working if we, for example, type the name of a method wrong. When we run the game, we can see that the door is opening and closing when we touch the trigger. To see the collision shapes in game, you can turn on visible collision shapes from the debug menu. Also, if you want to adjust the shape of the trigger, use the editable children feature and either create a new shape or make the one the trigger is using unique, since otherwise they would share the same shape resource. With that, we've created a reusable trigger that we can use to quickly add interactions to our game. The last thing I'm going to show you is how to create interactable objects for your game. These are objects where when the player is in range, they can give an input action and something happens. To demonstrate this, I've created this number display, and beneath it, a plus and a minus button. The number display is very simple. it has an add and a subtract method that change a value variable, and a refresh display method that clamps the value and displays it as text using a label3D node. Inside the plus and minus buttons, I have this player interaction scene. You can see that just like the reusable trigger, it takes a node path and a method name to call. I've set up these to the add and subtract methods of the number display. Looking at the player interaction script, you can see that there is an interact method that gets the node and calls the method on it. There are also the usual area nodes, body entered and exited signal methods. I've created a new array variable in the player script called interactables. Inside these enter and exit methods, I'm checking whether the body is a player and then adding and removing this node cell to and from that array. This makes it so that while the player is touching this area, the node will be in that interactables array. I've modified the player script from the advanced movement tutorial to include the logic for these interactable objects. Inside the physics process, I'm finding the closest interactable using a new method, and then when the interact action is pressed and a closest interactable exists, I call the interact method on it. That interact method is the one from the previous script I showed you. If multiple interactable objects are in the player's range, I need to find which is the closest and only interact with that one. I do that in the findClosestInteractable method. If there is less than one interactable, we can just return null, since that means no interactables are in range and the array is empty. If there are more than one, we need to find the closest one by comparing distances. I do that by starting with a very large initial distance, infinity in this case, and using a for loop to go through the interactables to check whether I find a new smaller distance. I then set that as the new closest interactable and the new shortest distance. After the for loop, I can return the closest interactable. The last else condition is reached if there is only one interactable in the list, in which case I can just directly return that one. And that's it. In game, we can see that when I press the interact action near the buttons, the numbers on the screen update as expected. Even if I'm in the middle of the two buttons and inside the areas of both of them, I still only interact with the button closest to me. This tutorial showed you some ways of adding interactions to your games. I also showed you some generic methods of doing so that you can reuse in your projects to get results and iterate faster. These are just one way of doing things, and what's best depends on the game you're working on. Anyway, hopefully you found this useful, and if you have any questions, let me know in the comments. The project files are available for download in the video description. Please like the video and subscribe to support us in making more content like this, and thank you for watching.